Erev Tov, we're in Derech Hashem, finishing off Perek Beis, which in the standard edition would be in on page 20. But just to recap, the second subject, the second Perek spoke about Tachlis Abriya, the purpose of creation, and he explains how Hashem is the ultimate good, ultimate perfection, and he wants to give good. And because of that, he wants to give the ultimate good, not only partial good. He wants to give the ultimate good. The ultimate good is only him. And theoretically, according to the plan, it would be that he'd want to give the ultimate good to make this creation him. But that's not possible, because only God is God, and no God could be made, even by God. So the Eitzah that Hashem... Right, that's the wrong way to say it, but that's the way we say it, but we're speaking in human terms that Hashem devised the plan, but it means, of course, that it's Chachmasa Ein Sofit. So is that Hashem is going to give an opportunity to this creation to connect to Him in a way that He'll be benefiting and enjoying Hashem's perfection because He's connected to Him. We gave a mashal of a husband and a wife, that if there'd be somebody, a king, who'd want to give his ultimate good, everything he has good, he'd want to give it to somebody, there's no way that he can give it. Because he's the king, and he can't make anybody else the king. And even if he'd give them great presents, but it wouldn't be his ultimate good. But if he would marry a woman, and she'd become his queen, so then she'd be benefiting from all of his goodness, not because she's independent, but on the contrary, because of her dependence, she'll be benefiting and enjoying all of his perfection by the fact that she's connected to him. So Hashem made that the creation is going to be, that's going to be the way of the benefit, that they're going to be able to connect to him. Oz Bey said that it's not enough that Hashem should just give it, so to say, for free, that just a present, non-deserving, because it doesn't become the essence of that person. So it doesn't become atzmo. It's not going to be inherent, integral. It's going to be just, so to speak, slapped on. And that's not going to be the ultimate good. At the end of the parak, at the end of that oath, he said the reason why it's not the ultimate good is because it has to be ru'u yali davek. It has to be, there should be some compatibility. If the mashal we talk about a shidduch, so there has to be some connection between the husband and the wife, that she should be able to marry this king. So Hashem made that the person should be able to inherently internalize the fact that he's going to be connected to Hashem. We don't know that yet, we don't know that it's us, but the creation that Hashem is going to make is going to be one that's going to have the ability on his own, of his own doing, to create that connection to Hashem. And then it's going to be somewhat similar and ru'yali davek. So Hashem is going to make certain shleimuyot and certain chesronot, certain perfections available in this creation that he's going to make. He's going to make certain perfections available for him and certain deficiencies, and it's going to be his ability to acquire it and internalize it into himself. And Oz Gimel said that besides the fact that this own acquisition of the qualities is going to make it ru'yali davek, appropriate, compatible, but that's going to be the actual way of connection. Because he goes on to explain that Hashem is the only perfection, and everything else, that anything else that is any kind of a perfection is only a hemshech v'tolada. It's like a branch off the root, that Hashem is the root of all perfection, Hashem is the root perfection, and anything that's going to exist, created perfections, are going to be a result of his perfection. And as he calls it, it's going to be a oras panim. There's going to be Hashem is emanating his perfection in a way that there are created perfections. So by person, by this creation that's going to be acquiring or perfections that Hashem made available, he's going to be in essence connecting to Hashem. That's as far as we got. And we're up to Os Dalet, page 20, Chelek Aleph, Perek Beis, Os Dalet. Vinei. In order that there should be in existence these different issues of shleimus and chisaron, perfection and deficiencies, which means that Hashem, before he said that Hashem is going to make in Oz Beis, at the end, he said that Hashem is going to make inyanei shleimus v'inyanei chisaron in a way that this creation is going to be able to acquire those shleimuyot for himself. So Hashem is going to make inyanei shleimus v'inyanei chisaron. He's going to make perfections and deficiencies. In order that there should be such a kind of a situation, and also v'simatzi habriya shezachanu batchuna shitzvicha liyos, and this creation means the Iker creation, that's the one who's going to be acquiring those perfections, should be in the proper temperament, you might say, have the properties that is necessary. What is the property that this creation must have? Pirush beefshavus l'shnei hanyanim uviyicholus aleihem sheitikna shleimus v'steyader menachasronos, that this creation should have the ability to both of the choices, either for perfection or for deficiency, and the ability to be able to acquire it for himself. And this creation should have the medium to be able to acquire it. Pirush liknos zashleimus. You have to have a creation that has ability to acquire shleimuyot, perfections, and to remove from itself deficiencies. So you need all of these things to be created. Before Hashem created anything, nothing was. So even the nyanei shleimus and nyanei chesaron also are created issues. Everything that's going to be what we'll call good, at the end we're going to call it good. The good and the bad, so those are created issues that Hashem made. So in order to have all of those things, plus the creation, that's going to be the purpose of creation, that he's going to have the ability to acquire those shleimuyot and remove those chesaronos from himself, all this needs a lot of creation. You must have many and different beings in this creation. And also very many interrelations between all of these different beings that are going to be created. In order to give success to this purpose that it was intended. In short, that when Hashem shows this to be the issue, that there's going to be a possibility to acquire the shleimuyot and ma'adir the chesronot, that a person, this creation is going to be able to acquire the perfections and remove the deficiencies. You have to make all these things. You have to invent and create all these things, all of these perfections and all of these deficiencies. And the one in the middle, this creation is going to have the ability to, and the medium to be able to acquire, to connect to all of those perfections and internalize it with himself. And now, of all, so there are many creations. Now, it's not only going to be one creation, there are going to be many creations. V'ulam ha-briya asher es'atidol le'inyin ha-godol ha-zeh d'haynu l'advekus bo yizborach sh'mo sh'zecharnu hi tikarei ha-ikarei sh'bechol ha-briya. The creation that is poised, that is destined for this great issue, which means to be connected to Hashem, that is going to be considered the main creation. There are going to be many creations. He said you have to have many creations in order to give such a background. But the ikr of the creation is only going to be that creation that's destined for the dveikus to Hashem. And the rest of the creation, v'chol shar ma sheyimotzei b'metzius, lo yeh ela ozer beizet tzad o beizet b'china ela tachlis. L'sheyislach v'yimotzei, everything else that exists is only going to be helping in some way, in some aspect, to the purpose that should be successful. That's going to be just that it should be successful. But everything else is just the background. You can call it the scenery, the environment. Everything else is just in order that this creation that's making the choice should be able to have that. But everything else is just background. Everything else is not the creation. It's not the purpose. Everything else is created, but they're not the purpose of creation. He's the only purpose. Everything else is just to help him get to his destination. So we learned whole perek, and this is all in the blueprint. It's all in the planning stage, so to speak. Hashem doesn't have to plan. Hashem is perfect without having, doesn't have to plan and think and figure it out. But this, spelling it out in slow motion, this was the plan that Hashem had for creation. And now, the last few lines is going to say the playlist of who's who in this creation. So we figured out already. Ach, ha'briya ikoros v'bemes yamin ha'noshi. The main creation is humankind, humanity. The human being, that's the purpose of creation. He's the one that Hashem made for this ultimate good. Just say it out for the mind-boggling experience, that it's a creation, man is a creation that has the ability to connect to Hashem. The utmost that a creation could connect to God. Hashem could have made the creation bigger and bigger, greater and greater. Hashem made it the greatest. Hashem made it with the greatest capacity to be able to connect to Hashem in the greatest connection in order to appreciate and enjoy and experience Hashem's perfection. Not that man is God. I just heard a drasha on this perek, and just to explain the difference, someone said that man is God. That man has God in himself. So it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that man is God. It means that there's some similarity that Hashem made, which has to be explained what Tzelem Elokim means. But we have to first clear away that surely man is not God, the neshama is not God, No, the Hashem is not God. Even though you hear it again and again, it's not true. It's apikorsis to say such a thing, that the Hashem is God. That's Christianity. Man is not God. God is not man. Man is not God. Simple. Aleph Beis. Everybody should know it. But for some reason, it gets confusing when people go into these subjects. It's not saying that man is God. It's saying that Hashem is giving ability to man to connect to Him. There's going to be a dveikus, but not that the neshama is God. Surely not. So the Bria Ikaris is humanity, and he's the one who's going to have the ability to connect to Hashem in the utmost way by choosing Shleimus and removing Chesronos. And what are those Shleimus and Chesron? Everything else is there for background. All those opportunities are for him. And we need all the other creations in order to give him those opportunities. Everything else that's created, either it's lower than him or higher than him, is only for him. It means even the higher creations, Malachim, Kochasan of Dalam, we'll get to everything. Even the highest creation that Hashem made, it's higher than man, but it's not the purpose. The purpose is man. Just to give a small mashal, if you have a kingdom and there's the king and he has a prince, a crown prince, and you have very many officers that are higher, more intelligent, and more powerful than this five-year-old that's playing in the sandbox, in the royal sandbox. But everything is just for him. In a real kingdom, the king is supposed to be serving the people, not that they're serving him. But just you look but within the structure of the government, so the sarim are there to be able to serve the king. The king will do his job. So even if he's a five-year-old who's in the sandbox, but all of the sarim and all the other officers and noblemen are just serving him. So that will be the mashal that Am Yisrael, even if they're less, I'm saying Am Yisrael, humanity, well, jumping, I have to go slow, that humanity is the purpose. And even the greatest malachim, greatest angels, and you go out in the outer space and you see it seems to be endless, all that is for man. All that is for the speck of dust called planet Earth, and planet Earth is for the purpose of man. Everything, and it can be spiritual beings, physical beings, everything else that exists is only for background and the stage, and the backdrop, all for man, to be able to make this choice of connecting to Shleimu Yot in order to be able to connect to Hashem. La ena mela bavuro la shlama sinyanav lefi kala b'chinos arabos v'ashonos arruyis limotze bohem v'kamo shavar od l'fanim b'siyata d'shma. Everything else is in order to complete his issue, the issue that he's necessary to be living in, as will be explained as we go further on in the Sefer. So far we know that man is the ikar of creation, and everything else is just the backdrop. What is the shleimus and chesronos that Hashem created in order for man to be able to choose the shleimus and remove the chesronos from himself? So that's the last paragraph. V'hinei haskalah v'chol amidos tovos heim inyanei shleimus shenimsu l'shtalein bohem ha'adam v'inyanei achomer umidos aros heim inyanei achisoron shezacharnu. The perfection issue that's available to man is haskalah and midas tovos. Haskalah means literally means intellect and good character. Midas tovos, good character. And chesaron is going to be chomer, which is opposite of seichel. We'll say seichel and chomer. The Rambam is very much built on this. Seichel means intellect, and chomer means materialism. And the opposite of midas tovos is midas roz, the good character and the bad character. He doesn't say mitzvahs and Averis. We would have expected right here. He would have said Mitzvahs and Averis. He doesn't say that. He says that the Shleimus and the Chesronos that are available to man is Haskalah, intellect, and good character. And Chisaron is materialism and bad character. Very big Chiddush. He doesn't talk about Mitzvahs yet. Just to explain what Haskalah means, Haskalah, intellect, in this sense, does not mean the intellect that's used for materialism. Then it goes back again to be materialism. If somebody's going to use intellect to figure out how to make a cake, so it's not called Haskalah. That's not the Haskalah we're talking about. It might even be astronomical figures of math. That's also not called Haskalah. Haskalah in this sense means the ability to know Hashem. The more that a person knows Hashem, that's called he's more muscular. He's using a person is true that a person has an intellect that animals don't have, and he can figure out mathematical cheshbonos, he can figure out how to musical notes, he can figure out medicine, he can figure out biology, physics, very big wisdoms. But that's not the wisdom he's talking about. The wisdom that man has that's inherently different than animal and anything is that he has the ability to know Hashem. Just to point out in Mar Mokam, a reference in the Sefer where he talks about this point. So on page 85 in the regular print, 85, that'll be Chelek Beis, Perek Ches, Os Dalid 284 Chelek Beis Perek Ches Os Dalid, page 85 in the regular editions, and towards the bottom he says Haskalah Hamita Shehi Ruach HaKodesh. Those are the words I just wanted to point out. There are other places in the Sefer where we use the same term, that Haskalah, the real Haskalah, the real intellect of man is in order to be able to know God. The philosophers, I think Aristotle, when he speaks about the difference between man and animal, he says, what is man? So he defined, you look at a plant, you see an animal, you see man, what is the difference? So he's going to define with the academic division, what is the difference? What do you see in an animal that a plant doesn't have? And what does man have that an animal doesn't have? So he came to the conclusion that intellect, but his intellect would say any kind of intellect, knowing things the way they are, that's called the quality of man over animal. And therefore they would spend their time, the philosophers, trying to know things. The more you know, the more muskil you are. And then whatever they think is going to happen at the end of that, he's going to be connected to the Seichel HaNivdol, whatever, Seichel HaPoel, Seichel HaNivdol, whatever they are referring to. But Aristotle's outlook of the quality of man, the shleimus of man, would be that he's able to be knowledgeable and intellectual, but nothing to do with God. That's not necessarily the shleimus of man. But that's a mistake. The difference between man and animal is that man could connect to Hashem. And the Haskalah that he has is to know Hashem, to know God, to perceive God, to be able, according to how much a person could. That's the Haskalah he's talking about. So man is going to have the ability of Haskalah, to know Hashem, and Chomer, which is materialism. Materialism is not necessarily going to mean something we call materialism, somebody's deep in materialism. Anything that doesn't have to do with Hashem, that's called materialistic. That's going to come up in, thank you very much, thank you. It's going to come up in Mesilas Yesharim and other places in the Sefer, that anything which doesn't evoke or connect a person to Hashem, that's called materialistic. It doesn't have to be dafka pizza, it could be a glass of water also. If it's something which is hiding Hashem, a person is not connecting to Hashem through it, so that's called materialistic. And a person is, yes?
The fact that a person is, let's say, Aristotle's opinion that it's
just the wisdom, intellect.
That isn't something more beneficial over animal?
It is, but it's not nothing more noble. It isn't the nobility of man, the fact that they could figure out mathematical
that's
problems. That's not the quality of man over animal. You might say that it's a more sophisticated animal.
That's the
purpose.
But isn't that something valuable?
So I would ask, if somebody's going to use all of his math in order to figure out how to make atom bombs and kill people and to make computers in order to be able to get the latest whatever they have on the internet over there. So is that considered something noble? They're using vast wisdom, but they're using it for lowliness. That we understand. If someone's going to take all of his wisdom in order to be able to make a good pizza, so we understand that he's taking all of that Haskalah and turning it back into Chomerius again. That everybody would agree, right? I think.
Yeah, but the animal can't make a pizza.
Right. But is anything more noble about him? The fact that he can make a pizza and the dog cannot. So he just likes to look through the garbage, and the man can sit and make a pizza. But
that makes him.
He's a more sophisticated. It's a more sophisticated animal, and the fact he's just eating. The Rambam, he's quoting Aristotle. He's very happy with Aristotle's description. He says that in that a man eats just for the enjoyment, and that's not the human part of him. That's the animal part of him. The fact that he's just eating, he says a very strong statement that if a person's whole decision of what he's going to eat is only on how it tastes. So he says, there's no difference to me between this person and an animal and a dog is all the same. I don't see the difference between a person who only eats because of his enjoyment, his physical taste and touch, than an animal. That's animalistic. Everyone agrees with that, that the point of eating is the animals eat also. So the fact that he knows how to make a pizza that the dog cannot make doesn't make him any more noble. I would think.
You could say that also that, I mean, you look at every single creature and every single creation, and you see that each one of them was given an innate ability and a koach that is completely different between that insect or that lion. Each one has its
own nature, right? Tools
that the Roshan gives them in order to survive and feed themselves and live. So on that aspect, They're all different, and humans
are all different. But it's not going to be that one is more noble than the other. One might be more sophisticated than the other. Correct. But if they're all eating, right, and he catches his food like this,
they all have that ability.
Yes.
The difference is a human.
More sophisticated.
Much more sophisticated.
Okay, but so.
Yeah, but
that doesn't make. That's not going to be the. Yes, but if the decision.
How I was planning.
Yes.
Said that
Shemesh
is the
vehicle
in the house.
Right. So we're saying that Haskalah.
All those things don't make that.
Right. True.
Haskalah.
If it's true that the man is going to be able to make more sophisticated, that doesn't make him more noble. That's not the difference between man. That's not man's issue. That doesn't divide him from being another animal. The difference of man is that he's able to understand Hashem, get close to Hashem, to understand Hashem.
Is that the reference?
We'll talk about Selam. Selam Akim is not the subject over here. Some of Farshim and Chumash do say that, but the Ramchal wouldn't say it, so we'll keep it meanwhile.
The fact that, let's say, a human could figure out that you first eat bread and then chicken and then you eat that.
But it's just another way of eating. The animal's going to do it by instinct anyway.
You have a monkey and you have an ant, and the monkey can do a lot more things than the ant.
The monkey can't determine.
So he's if a human is going to decide, is he going to eat pizza or is he going to eat tomato chips, potato chips, that's not going to be anything noble about man. That's not man. That's not a man. That's not shot in a man. So someone might think so, but that would make him into a sophisticated animal. Aristotle himself wouldn't be machshav such a man. Aristotle's going to be machshav if somebody's been able to think about a mathematical solution. He's human. Or if he knows things the way they are, he understands sciences. That would be considered, say, something more than animal. But the fact that he eats, or he determines what to eat, or he knows how to make food, the animals do that also. So the animals also, you put two pieces of food in front of the animal, he's also going to choose what he wants. But it's going to be by instinct, it's not going to be by... It's instinct that's called. Right. That's not defining man. Okay, just to get the heart, that's the simple words, know what he means to say, that the shleimus and chesedim that Hashem made available to man is haskalah midas tovos, and on the other hand is going to be chomer and midas roos. The question everybody asks always when they get here is that what happened to mitzvahs and averus? Like that's, we're Jewish. We know the end of the plan. We know it is a Torah, mitzvahs. So how can it be that he doesn't say that the shleimus is the mitzvahs and chisorin is the averus? So later on, he does talk about mitzvahs and averus. And over there, he's going to explain that the mitzvahs and averus are just guiding and channeling us to have the right haskalah and midas tovos. The issue is the midas tovos and the... let's say we say midas tovos, but what's the midas tova? What's the midah raw? You can find today that many people have different ideas of what's considered good and bad. So you have to have the mitzvahs in order to guide us, to tell us what is the good, what is the bad. And to know Hashem, you have to have Torah in order to know Hashem. And the chomer, if you don't have Torah, you're going to be sinking in the chomer. So the mitzvahs and averus are going to be guiding a person to be able to get the haskalah and the midas tovos. But not that the mitzvah is the end in itself. The mitzvah is the guidelines of what to know and what character to have. That's the Ramchal later on in the Sefer when he speaks about mitzvahs and averus. I think just to give a reference, it's going to be in page 33. That's Chelek Aleph, Perek Dalid, Osei, and on. It starts really from the beginning of the Perek, but the main point that he says about mitzvahs and averus is over there in Aleph, Dalid, Hey. Chelek Aleph, Perek Dalid, Osei. So we finished more or less the second parak, which was about the purpose of creation. Purpose of creation was in order to make a creation that's going to be able to enjoy the utmost good that Hashem could offer, and that is to be connected to Him, and the utmost connection that a creation could be connected to the Creator, and that he should do it on his own. He should be deserving, because then it's going to become actually him, and also he'll be royally davek. He'll be compatible to connect to Hashem, and also this is the way to actually connect to Hashem. And everything else that's created is just going to be those shleimuyot and chesronot in order to give him the scenery, the background, in order to have that opportunity. Everything else is not considered the ikar of the creation, only that creation that's going to be able to make the choice. And that is man. Man is the purpose of all creation, and everything else is not the purpose, just the medium in order to make that available to man. Just to point out a small footnote, that the Rambam in Morne Buchim, he says that those creations that are greater than man, he didn't know that is for the purpose of man. The Rambam says that everything that's below man, we understand that it's serving him. But it talks about the higher creations and even the heavenly bodies, he says we don't know that it's for man. But the Ramchal is saying that it is. Everything that's created is for man, and also there are many Gemaras that seem to side with the Ramchal, that even the higher creations also, the purpose is man. Man is the purpose of all creation.
The the Rambam says that he didn't know, or
no, he says that it's impossible to know.
Impossible
to know. Mar Nevuchim, Chelik Beis, Perik Chof Hei. And also Perik Gimel, Perik Yud Beis, if anybody wants to look up the references.
For us to know.
Isn't it different now that you know that everything is for you?
Yeah, but we don't have a connection with the...
So there is, we don't know, maybe there is. We go on in the Sefer, you might have a connection to the Malachim. The Malachim were created for man. It's, later on he's going to explain what Malachim's place in creation is, what they're doing for us. But everything that's created is for man. Doesn't mean that now they were greater than them, but with a purpose. Eventually, we'll see that a man could become greater, that is going to become greater than Malachim. But even if at this stage the Malach is greater, but even his greatness is only serving man. Man is the purpose. So if that's good, we can go on to Perek Shlishi.
That whole argument about whether man is greater than Malachim because man's got the Kira.
Yes, so that's not a machlokis. That's going to be, it's true that man at this stage, right now, when he's in a situation of evil and he's susceptible to evil, so he's in, you could say that he's lower than Malachim. Malachim are much greater, both intellectually and powerful, and also they're closer to Hashem. But that'll call them greater, but they're still not the purpose. We're agreeing that Malachim are greater than man. But they're not the purpose. The purpose is, even the purpose of their creation is only in order to benefit man, and later on we'll explain
if
how.
If they've got no Bechira, why would that make them greater? Wouldn't that be compared to Ki'ilu, like a robot?
So we're not talking about if it's inherently them, but we're talking about that their qualities are greater qualities. You're right, they don't have Bechira, but they are on a much higher level. They are very close to, they're much, much closer to Hashem than we are, so their intellect is more, their koach is more, so that'll call them a greater being. But you're right, and the essence of making the choice is going to be us, and eventually we're going to be bigger than the Malachim. But so we're just differentiating between the word greater, maybe in the translation what the word greater means. Just in the language we're talking here, we said the Ashlemus and Chesronus, but they said man has to do it on his own in order to be him. So that aspect of Malachim don't have. They have Shlemus, much more than man, but they didn't internalize it on themselves. It's not integrally them. It just was, this was the point. It would have been man also. If it wouldn't have been his own choice, then it would be that Hashem gave it to him as a present. That would be the Malachim. The level of a Malach is that they're very Shalem. They have a lot of perfections in Haskalah and Midas Tovas, whatever is going to be considered a perfection, but it wasn't their doing. So it's not them. It's not Bala Tovahu. It's not Ba'atzmo. It's not in his essence. It's Mikri, incidental on them. It's not their essence. So that is the issue of the first parak was about God, what we know about God. The second parak is what we know about the purpose of creation. And since he finished off saying that man is the purpose, now he's going to go on. The next parak is called Hamina Anoshi, humankind, all about humanity. So if we're ready to start, Chelek Aleph, Parak Gimel, Os Aleph. Far Zacharnu. First he's going to recap some of what he said, then he's going to say some more additional. Far Zacharnu. Hayosa Adam Mosar Briya Hanivreis Lidaveg Bo Yisborach. We've already mentioned, well, we just recapped already ourselves, that man is that creation that was created in order to connect to Hashem, and it is he, that man, that is placed in between Shlemus and Chesronos, and he has the ability to acquire Shlemus. He's put into a situation of our world, which has opportunities for perfection and deficiency. Later on, we didn't mention that, later on he talks about examples of this. There's going to be all kinds of scenarios where one person is can have an opportunity for humility or arrogance, or for anger, all kinds of midos. In the issue of midos, he'll have opportunities that will set forth a nisayon. It's going to be a test for him in order to get angry. So he's going to be able to stay away from anger and be able to acquire being level-headed. And another person can have an opportunity where he might be compassionate or he might be cruel. Person might be arrogant or might be humble. All these are considered, all this, the whole scenario, is God orchestrated. Hashem made it in a way that there should be such a situation where one person should be able to have compassion on the other. So one person will be rich, one person will be poor, and therefore Lavdin Isayon, should he be compassionate or not? So all that is the background for the test of man, or the opportunity to be able to acquire perfection. So that's a lot of doing to make a situation where one person is rich, one person is poor. Everything that goes into that, that's called the background. And everything in the world is background to a man's purpose to make a choice. So here he says, that was all recapping what I said before. It has to be with his own choice and will. it seems like he's repeating what I said before already, but he's not, because before he didn't mention the word Bechira and Ratzon. Later on he's going to say Das and Chayfetz. Before he said that, the man has to do it on his own. But he's adding on an extra Chiddush here, that if he would have the opportunity and he would acquire the Shleimus, but he was forced to do it, so it's still not called that he did it. We take it as a given already, but he's saying it in two different stages. The first stage, he said before, in page 19 over there, Oz Beis, we'll call it Beis Beis, Perik Beis, Oz Beis, over there he said that he has to be the one that acquires it. But now in Gimel Aleph, he's saying that it has to be with his willing choice. He has to do it with his own will. Even if he would do it, the act.
If he's only inclined to do that,
right.
That's not called.
It's not called his, even though he acquired it. It's like, yeah, the father tells the child, say thank you. So he says thank you. So is it a shleimus to say thank you? Yes, it's a shleimus to say thank you. And he did it. But it's still, since he didn't do it, but Bechira v'chepetz, it's not called that the son did it. It's called that the father did it. The father said thank you. If the father tells the son to say thank you, so the father said thank you, not the son. So he's adding on another ingredient, that it's not enough that the creation is going to have the ability and the medium to acquire the shleimus. It has to be that he does it with his own will. Well, that's the issue of this first paragraph is being mechadesh. It's introducing the issue that it has to be with his own will. The will is coming in over here, and that means that he has to have equal inclination to both sides, or else it wouldn't be called that he did it with his own desire and will. It wasn't his own decision. To make a decision, it has to mean that he has an equal inclination to both sides. So we're adding in another. There's new factors coming in. Besides that, the shleimus and the chesaron is there available for him. He also has to be inclined to do both of them. It has to be a meshicha. There's going to be an inclination to do the good, there's an inclination to do the bad. And then he has to make a choice. So this is an added ingredient that he didn't say till now. It's a long sentence, but just to translate it. However, this has to be with his own choice and will. Because if he would be forced in his actions to choose, in any case, Shleimus, means he has no choice in the matter. He's going to do it, but he has no choice in the matter. He must choose Shleimus. He must do the Shleimus. So then it wouldn't be called in truth that he is the owner of his Shleimus, because he's not the owner, because he was forced from another to acquire it. And the one who made him acquire it, he's the Baal Shleimus, like the mashal of the father. The father who says thank you, he's the one who said thank you. He's the one who did it. Even though the son actually is the one who said the word, but the father is the one who made him do it. So then, if Hashem is going to make us in a situation where we're going to be forced, no matter how we'll be forced, either because we don't see the other side, or another forceful, whatever it's going to be, it's always going to be that Hashem is the one who did it for us, and again, we didn't do it ourselves. And Hashem's intention wouldn't have been fulfilled. Hashem's intention was that we should do it, not that he should do it. So therefore, Hashem left it to our choice and our will, our free will. Now we're bringing an issue of will. Therefore, it was necessary to leave the issue to his own choice. What does that mean? The word netiya means an inclination. He should have a balanced, equal inclination to both sides, which is a chiddush. That now he has shleimus and chesaron, and it's not just, yeah, for sure shleimus, what's the question? No, he has an equal inclination to do the evil also. He's not forced into any side. Again, the word das, chayfetz, which we didn't have these words before. Said that he has the power of choice to choose knowledgeably and willingly whichever one he wants. This was said already before, that he has the ability to acquire it. Therefore, a person was created with a good inclination and an evil inclination. And he has the ability to make the choice to incline himself to either side that he wants. So this is the issue of Bechira, that he has free choice. But free choice means that he has the inclination to both sides. The word Yetzer Tov, Yetzer Ra, sometimes the Yetzer Ra is referred to as an angel, as a malach who's trying to trip people up. And that has truth to it. The Gemara says there is such a thing as a malach who's a Yetzer Ra, who has something with a malach hamavis, who Yetzer Ra. There's a malach, there's an angel that's trying to, his job is to try to make people stumble. But here he's not talking about that. Here he's talking about Nivri Ha'adam bi Yetzer Tov, bi Yetzer Ra, that a person is created with the word Yetzer in the Pasuk usually means an inclination, a desire. Like it says, Ki Yetzer Lev Ha'adam Ra Menu Rav, And the other pasuk we say also in the Volatzion, Yetzer Machshavos Levav Amecha. The word Yetzer goes together. The word Yetzer means inclination, a desire. That's how the Mefarshim, the Radak, others, and the Sefer Shirashim, they say that the word Yetzer means an inclination, and that's how we call Yetzer Ra, the evil inclination. That doesn't mean the a malach. That doesn't mean an angel. There is an angel. The Gemara says there is an angel. I think in the Psukim you might not find it. I'm not sure. If anybody has any, in the Psukim alone, do you see that there's an angel that's a Yetzer Hara? Maybe the Nachash in the story of Bereishis. Maybe the Nachash is the Yetzer Hara. But as far as the term Yetzer Hara, you don't find that to mean a Malach as much as it means the inclination of man.
So animal also has the Yetzer?
The Gemara might talk about that, but that would be an instinct. It'll be an instinct, and he's forced by his instincts. But here we have a choice.
We have a choice, but the fact that we're desiring.
But you have two desires. The animal is forced by his instinct. He doesn't have any desire. You can say he makes a choice. Before I said example, if you put two kinds of food in front of him, he'll take what he wants. But he's not making a decision. He's just being forced by his instinct. What he's going to which one he's going to take. It's not that he's making a decision. By a human, it's called a willful decision. That's the issue of Bechira. There's an interesting point that someone points out, that there's the you don't find the malach of a Yetzer Tov. Interesting that interesting observation. And the Gemara and Midrashim, I don't recall that there's a malach that's a Yetzer Tov. You always find the malach who's a Yetzer Hara, but you don't find the malach who's a Yetzer Tov. So I don't have any explanation, I don't know. But as far as inclination, we do have a good inclination and a bad evil inclination. As far as the malach, you just find a malach of a Yetzer Hara, if anybody knows about
it.
Right, over there it's talking about a good malach and evil malach, but it's not talking about inclinations over there. There it's talking about there's a good malach means his job is to do good. And an evil malach would mean like a destructive malach. We know that we do know that there are destructive malachim. But as far as and the malach, his job is to stumble, you find a Yetzer Ra, I don't know if you call the Yetzer Tov.
The man is already built in with a Yetzer Tov, so.
But also a Yetzer Hara. He has a Meshicha.
Yeah, but you need the Yetzer Ra from outside to be able to let him get in.
Somewhere. Why is it not enough just to have the inclination on both sides? El-Khor would have been enough to have an inclination on both sides. I'm not sure, I'm saying a question. You do find that the Gemara says there's a Malach that is trying to trip a person up. But if there's inclination and on the Yetzer Tov side is the inclination, so why is it not enough on the Yetzer Hara side? Inclination to both sides.
As I said, you're built in with the Yetzer Tov.
But he's built in with the Yetzer Hara also.
Mm-hmm.
But
not strong enough.
But why not? Hashem is making it equal. Right? Hashem could have made it equal. The Hara did make it equal. So why is it necessary to have an outside force also besides the inner force? Leave it as if anybody has what to say, I'm happy. I haven't gotten an answer yet. I don't know.
The question is why there isn't malach.
Why is it necessary to have, as far as a person's inclination, we find that he has two inclinations. He has Yetzer Tov, Yetzer Ra. As far as the outside force that's trying to advise him, so you do find the Yetzer Hara, we don't find the Yetzer Tov, as far as I know. Somebody, one midrash where maybe he mentions the Yetzer Tov as a malach, but I don't know if it was strong enough to, like, one midrash, not a regular kind of a midrash. So I'm not sure. I'm leaving it as a question. Is there an outside malach that's also trying to help a person to do the mitzvahs? The Yetzer Hara is trying to stumble and making him tachbulot. He has all kinds of strategies how to trip up the person. Is there a malach who's a Yetzer Tov?
The Rosh says that a person has a good thought, then he creates a malach which is meilitz alav.
But that's not the subject. Okay, but that's not a subject of his meilitz. But it's not a question of his Yetzer Tov. It helps him to
achieve that a good thought.
And he calls it a malach. He doesn't just call it his inclination.
The one in Ever Chavez.
Right, but it doesn't say over there that it's a Yetzer. It says a malach that does good, a malach that does bad. But it's not talking about his inclination. It's not making him to do good.
It wouldn't make sense if it was helping him to come, especially to help him, because then he wouldn't have free choice.
Okay, so you have two malachim on the outside. If anything is going to be an advisor, somebody on the outside. But you still have the choice. The malachim, even if they're not going to be malachim, it's not going to be that they make the choice. You're the one who's making the choice. What?
It's supposed to be even balanced.
Yes, evenly balanced. And he's going to say it again and again, it's evenly balanced. The question is, we feel sometimes that it's not.
If it's good and bad,
yes.
And there's nothing more forceful to the bad,
right.
It's not really evenly balanced.
I'm sorry. If you have inclination towards good and at least inclination towards bad, equal inclination towards both.
Then
now you make a choice.
Really balanced.
Why not?
You have your brain.
You have to, so now you're going to decide.
Yeah, but
you're going to be the deciding factor. You, man, is the deciding factor between these two inclinations. Man has two inclinations,
right, so
and he has also
really
a deciding factor.
Balance, because you have a brain to the good side.
No, the brain is now the brain. Whatever you want to call it, the deciding factor. That is now he. There's
that
but there's a ratzon.
It will always go to the good. It will never decide for the bad.
Why not?
There's nothing pulling it to the bad. Why would someone's mind make him go to the bad?
Because he has all of that inclination. The ice cream is good. There's
the
something that's pulling him.
Mind will never give it to that. It's only if an outside factor pulls him to the.
It is possible that the mind. If the mind is the mind is the intellect part of the good inclination?
No.
You don't think
because
so?
Because there is a das hevora since chet adam rishon.
So there's
and
going
he
to
has his own teidoy, what's good and bad.
So there's but there's intellect that he could figure out what's good and bad.
But
there's the inclination.
The neshama is.
Okay, we didn't get to the neshama yet. We don't know about the neshama yet. So that's going to be the next paragraph. So if I talks about man, that he has an inclination towards both, and he's the deciding factor. Okay, we hear all that tzedim, but just to get the picture that he says so far is that man has. Two inclinations. The word Yisrael will translate as inclinations. He has an inclination to both. As someone pointed out, they heard from Nassim Rothman that he says that it's a very important point. He said that it's very important for man to realize this. Sometimes people, they are trying to understand themselves and they see that they have inclination towards bad. They have inclination to do the bad. But they know that it's not right. They know that it's not right. Mm-hmm. Because of that, they feel that there's a Muhammad, there's a battle between their intellect and their desire. They look at themselves that their desire is to do bad. Their desire is to do bad, but they know in their intellect they know what's good. So they make it into a battle between their intellect and their desire. So he said it's a big insult to humanity. It's not true. Man has a desire to do good, not only in his intellect. He has a desire to do good. Look, Petishkach, check it out. You'll see that a man has a desire to be good, not just because he knows it's good. He wants to be good. Call it the word want. He wants to be good. He wants to be evil also sometimes. And people, because of that, because they don't understand themselves, they say, am I schizophrenic? Like, what am I? I don't know what I am. So because of that, they say that I must be bad. I must have a desire for bad. But I know, in my intellect, I know that it's not good. So it's a muhammad between my intellect and my desire. So he says, no, that's not true. There are two desires. There's a desire for good, there's a desire for bad. You have both, and now your job is to be magbir, to strengthen one of your desires. But it's not true, man. It's not all bad. Over there, Yitzchak Shavos Libo Rak Rak Kol Hayom, not to be taken literal. It means that there's also a Meshicha, there is a Yetzer Tov, there is a desire to be good. Isn't it true? Once the question is put on the table, isn't it true that man also has an innate desire to be good? It isn't just.
I only say it because there is a man. A man was Magubul von Amaim Tachtonim, and the Amaim Medonim are all the Kirchas Ashpar, and like there it says, the Amaim Tachtonim always.
So there is an inclination to be good. Don't we feel that there's an inclination to be good?
But you have to train yourself to.
There's an inclination to be bad also. There's both. I understand that there's both. The whole point is that he should make a decision. So he has a Muhammad, but there's a desire for both. There's a Shleimus and a Chesronus. There's a Meshicha. There's an inclination towards the good. There's an inclination towards the bad. And his job is to decide.
One of the definitions of the tzaddik is that he's trained himself to only listen to the good side. He doesn't know what it is.
Yes. That, I don't know if that's the only that's the definition.
The bad side completely.
Yeah, we'll get to that. If it's possible to defeat it completely, but yeah. That is what man. That's what the tzaddik is. The tzaddik is one who is choosing the good.
But according to that, huge chiddush that he only gets his chutz when he did something to kurech habechirim.
Yes.
A huge chiddush.
What?
The chiddush that a person wouldn't get any credit only if he does something with his own free will. It's not enough. What would you think? That there's a point. There's an important point to make over here. Some people, they are under the impression that a person that there people would think that the only credit to man is only what he does with his free will. It only depends what the free will was. It doesn't make a difference what he did as long as he uses free will for good. but we look at the Sefer now, it's a little different. First he says there's a thing called Shlemus, there's a thing called Chesronus. And a person acquires Shlemus, he acquired Shlemus, and he's Re'oili Davek, he's compatible to connect to Hashem, and he's thereby actually connecting to Hashem. But then there's another factor that it has to be Baal Shlemus, so he has to be the one who did it to himself. He's the one, he has to be inherent. So the issue of the Bechira is just to make it that he's the Baal Shlemus, but there's such an issue as Shlemus. In other words, let's say there's two people. One person was born in a neighborhood where everybody is murderers. Again, his neighborhood, everybody's murderers. And he thought about it, and he worked on himself. He came to the conclusion he's not going to be a murderer, he's just going to be a gamel. He's just going to be a thief, but he's not going to murder. And it was very hard because all of the peer pressure and all the chinuch that he got and all that slacha that he sees is all in murdering. And he's going to be a tzaddik and he's going to stay away. He's only going to steal. So you'll say, as far as the bechira, that he had to work on himself in order to make this decision, he worked on himself very much. That's one person. The other person was born into a family where they're all tzaddikim, kedoshim, tahorim. And the question is, if he's going to do mitzvahs at a rate of, you know, a certain amount of miles per hour, or he's going to do it with all his strength, he's going to work harder, is he going to stay up late in order to have another night seder, or he's going to take it easy. His makom nisayon, let's say the two people, they work the same on themselves to come to their decision of doing good. Are they the same? This person has many more shleimiyot. He's first of pearl of shleim. The other person is okay, you know, like he's not a murderer and he deserves a lot of credit for it. No, he deserves a lot of credit for it. He's going to get credit for it. But he's not a shalem. He's doing all kinds of averus. And even if the person was less successful, the higher person, the kadosh person, he was less successful in his bechira, but still, as far as the shlemus that he's doing the whole day, he's also in shlemus. He does chesed and tzedakah and rachamim and Torah and avoda the whole day. But he missed something up in the bechira. In the bechira aspect, he was a bit less than the other person. But you can't ignore the shlemuyot. So the sefer suggests and presents two issues. One issue is the issue of shlemus against chesaron, and we have the ability to acquire shlemuyos. The other issue is that it should be you. And the you, how much you acquired into yourself, that's dependent on how much you made a willful decision, that you had a bechira. So we're not saying that a person doesn't have any shlemus if he didn't do it with his own free will, but it's not called him. It isn't Baal Shlemusa. Baal HaTovahu.
What's the catch? The
Ganef
is better?
He's not better. The other person has more shlemus, but he has a better achiza. He's more Baal Shlemus. That Shlemus that he got, that he's not going to murder, he has a better handle on it. It's more him. It's his
as.
Right, he acquired it. He put it into himself. So that he got a bigger achiza in that Shlemus of not murdering. And the other person has much bigger Shlemuyot, but he didn't have such a big achiza on it. It's not as much him in his essence. So there's two issues. One is the Shlemus, one is how much is Baal Shlemus. That you should know what his issues are.
You don't know, but
now we're saying that the issue is not only Bechira, it's also the Shlemus. It's also, if you see somebody doing something that's Shalem, you see that he's being a Tzaddik, he's doing a Tzaddik. How hard it is for him? That's another issue of how much is internalized into his essence that it's him. But he has a quality that the other one doesn't have. And the person who's doing Averis, succeeding and not doing a big Averis, only doing small Averis, so he has a big Achizah on it, but it's still, he's very Chaser. He's not as Shalem. Yashar Koach Achim.